Welcome, everyone. We're just giving everyone a chance to log in, but I've got a few words to say before we move into the meat of the conversation. So I'll go ahead and get that over with while people are logging in. So for those who may not be familiar with the National Academies, we're a private nonprofit institutions that provide expert advice on some of the most pressing challenges facing the nation and the world. You are logged into a monthly meeting of the 2025 to 2035 Decadal Survey of Ocean Sciences for the National Science Foundation Committee. I'm the study director and a senior program officer for the Ocean Studies Board. So we'll put a link to the project website in the chat, and this is where you can find the committee statement of task, the list of the committee membership and their bios. And you can also find information on our past events as well as upcoming events. So this is a public meeting. And the purpose is to hear from experts in the community and enrich the committee's discussions as they develop the study's findings, conclusions, and recommendations. So specifically for today, we'll have a discussion with NSF's Directorate for Geosciences, followed by a discussion on smart cables. So Dr. Alex Eisern is up first. She's currently the Assistant Director for Geosciences at the National Science Foundation. Previously, she was head of the Antarctic Sciences Section at NSF's Office of Polar Programs. Welcome, Alex.
Thanks so much, Kelly. And thank you all for the invitation. Sorry that I couldn't be at the last session that you had. And it would have been nice to be in person. But our sincere thanks for taking on this difficult task for this committee. As you all know, the last decadal really provided us with a critical roadmap that has helped guide the ocean sciences on a steady path of keeping a good balance between facilities investments and research investments. And those challenges are still persisting. So again, the work that you're doing will be critical for us moving forward. So thank you so much. I didn't have anything specific. I felt best thing is to save the time and for your questions and anything that I could provide in the way of help or input.
Yeah, thank you, Alex. So, you know, of course, anything that you can think of that will help us make the Decadal Survey most helpful to you all is, of course, appreciative. But I know that the committee had some specific questions for you. So I'll let you guys raise your hands and I'll ask in the order of hand raises. Ajit.
Hi, Alex. I'm glad you sort of introduced it the way you did. Fully understand this issue of infrastructure versus research, but still can't help being struck, if that's the right word, by the FY25 budget request, where OCE is actually taking a 7% reduction in its research budget. And so, I mean, and that's the best possible scenario so far as I can see. I was just wondering if you can provide some sort of context for that in the sense, okay, let me try and rephrase that. Sorry, that's not the question I meant to ask. We are trying to figure out what the next 10 years are going to look like. And we're beginning this with the reduction in the budget. And I'm just trying to figure out how to wrap my head around thinking about this. I don't know if that's much of a question, but is this something that came up? You know, that I can't help not being sort of challenged by how to think about it.
No, it is a challenge. And that's why this the activity that, you know, this committee and your deliberations are so critical, and why, you know, for us, certainly what would be most helpful is a really thoughtful set of priorities. I think if we have a very long list of kind of everything that, you know, people can think of, which is just not going to help us navigate what are, you know, we have our 2024 budgets, a big challenge, 25. That, you know, right now, 25, it's all the budget, president's budget's always a policy statement. You know, we're in an election year, and so we don't know where that'll end up. It's likely to be challenging again. And then 26 will be a new administration either way. And so I think that We need to stay in close lockstep with what the community feels are the highest priorities, and that certainly includes facilities, and particularly in the case of ocean sciences. Although across the board in geo, this is a real challenge for us right now, is just this balance. We're seeing the facility costs go up as not only people costs go up, but you know, everything related to materials, fuel, it's just a real challenge to balance that. So, you know, certainly the director feels strongly that we need to look at our budgets in the context of stop, start, continue. We have to keep our investments at the cutting edge. And as such, we can't do everything. So we need to probably stop some things we're doing. And that's, again, where advice that this committee would have on what are some things possibly that we are investing in, either in research or infrastructure, that maybe isn't either still on the forefront or is maybe not as high priority as something else. We need to hear from you. Those decisions will have to get made no matter what, but that's why we really need to hear that from the community. But it's clear in an era where budgets, we're trying to get to balanced budgets, I think the reality is that there's going to be some hard decisions to be made. And that's where, again, you know, we need to have really forward thinking. We're obviously at a time that, you know, certainly the taxpayer with, you know, the climate imperative we're facing, what are the most critical things to invest in while still keeping a robust foundational investment that we have in the core programs that we've always supported? So I don't know if I answered your question. I wasn't sure what the question was.
Right. No, for me, I guess I was trying my best not to be parochial or small-minded about it, trying to get the big picture. But I did notice that OCE has the largest reduction in its research budget. And that's essentially where I was struggling to understand, you know, given the costs, yes, I understand we need to balance things, but it is taking a big hit. And I'm trying to use that to contextualize the plans we're laying out for the next 10 years. So that's really what it was. I don't know if there's a question, so maybe we can move on.
Yeah. And again, you know, you kind of have to look at the OC budget as a whole compared to other things. Sometimes it could just be that in a way, it's the way something's been turned off versus other things being turned on. And so it looks like a negative when it's really, you know, not as bad as it seems. But again, FY25, it's a policy document. Josie.
Hey, Alex, great to see you. Thanks for being here. Building on Ajit's question, because I do think we're all considering just what he said, but, you know, the climate crisis is clearly looming. That's what we're going to be facing. We are facing. It's only going to get worse in the next, decade. And I'm wondering from your perspective, besides the budget, which is absolutely critical, what other roadblocks are you seeing in terms of maybe interdisciplinary, interagency? If we are in a time of reduced budgets, how do we be more creative in terms of leveraging other assets? And I'd love to hear you must be thinking about these things on a daily basis, so your perspective would be really helpful.
Yeah, that's a good question. So we have brought on Doug Kowaleski, who was in Antarctic Sciences and a force of nature as far as really thinking about partnerships in geo more broadly, but he's been working very closely with the divisions as well. And as you say, we've certainly been doing a lot of thinking about that and a lot of actions. We've built really strong partnerships with TIP, sort of thinking about the innovation space. We've also been starting discussions with philanthropies. We've had a few successes, no big dollars maybe yet, but I think where that's been a challenge, a nice challenge, but still a challenge, is we have to move away from thinking how can we tap into their resources to what unique capability do we have at NSF to help them meet their mission, because ultimately that's what they want to do, as we do. But so we've been thinking a lot about partnerships and where there's some unique opportunities there. Partnerships with other agencies, as you know, we we have close, we have biweekly discussions with NOAA, ONR, et cetera. I think the challenge there is, you know, a little bit about a little bit the federal budget system, budget process, and how, you know, it's hard to coordinate across the agencies, but we do keep in close contact. And I think we have had some really good examples of strong partnerships. One is the IUCRC program that, which is an industry university consortium activity that we are doing with NOAA, and actually US Treasury's asked to join, looking at how we can make those links between the university's industry and the federal agencies in the space of developing more robust models for modeling, for climate models, but specifically geared to the insurance industry, which if anyone has any relatives in Florida, or if you have property in Florida, you'll know that that's just gotten out of control. And in some California, they're not even offering policies in some places. So we've been trying to do, you know, to find those niches where we have that unique connection. But we are continually doing that because we do recognize the importance of being able to leverage not only the funding, but also, you know, ensuring that those kind of those investments that we want to make to really make strong advances, that we can make those.
Thank you. Jim?
Yeah, this is, hi, Alex.
Hey,
good
Jim.
To see you again. This is a hypothetical question, but we haven't gotten around to making recommendations, even related to the interim report yet. But if we made a recommendation that NSF should pursue a replacement drill ship, assuming there's support for that in ocean sciences, how do you see that at the geo level fitting in with probably other priorities you have for major research equipment?
Boy, that's a challenge. That's a hard one. You know, I think the challenge with obviously the science of the drilling program is high priority. It has been for many, many, many years. I think really the challenge is that's always been such a strong international partnership with a strong financial cost share. And if we have to do all of the carrying of that investment, that's a challenge, you know? And so, but if it's the highest community priority, I mean, I think you all are well positioned to really provide advice. That's one of the, I think for this decadal, it's going to be one of the biggest challenges is how to place that within the context of all the other challenges that, or all the other priorities, research priorities and facility priorities that we have. You know, it's a hard one to answer because I don't want to load the question or load the response, let's say. But certainly, you know, we've been talking a lot about it, obviously, and really, I think Jim has put forward a really good pathway to exploring what this all could look like. And we'll be establishing a subcommittee of the advisory committee to really look closely at costs and you know, so we can make a wise decision in the end, again, taking in community input and knowing what the real situation will be. But yeah, facilities are going to be a big challenge for us. I think that, you know, for the geosciences, that's going to be a decadal challenge. And we've been talking internally about how can we essentially really on an enterprise risk management level, better understand the risks of the facilities we're carrying, because as we learned with the 24 budget, you know, it's the, you know, that's a part of our budget that's not that agile. So.
Thank you.
Thanks, Allison.
Thanks, Kelly. Alex, you mentioned partnering with TIP, and I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about that program and how you see its funding support taking place going forward. My understanding is that some of the initial funding that was used to establish that program is coming to an end. And so individual program offices might be asked to contribute to keeping that program running. And I'm wondering if you could speak to that a little bit and how you see TIP interfacing with some of the directorates.
So TIP is a directorate. It's a cross-cutting directorate in a similar vein as the Education Directorate or Office of Integrative Activities or International. So it really cross-cuts the whole agency. So it is a line in our budget that was just codified in the CHIPS and Science Act. And so I know I almost feel sorry for the staff there. They're always kind of getting accused of robbing everybody's lunch when they've had their own money appropriated. In fact, last budget cycle, they had a big supplemental, which really got them closer to what the vision was, but that's supplemental, it's one-time funding. But nevertheless, they are a directorate. We've been working closely with them on a few fronts. One was the CHIRP solicitation that just was released, CHIRP with two R's, not one. Looking at sort of the nexus between the basic research needed to understand resiliency, the community-based involvement to really have community-based solutions, but also the innovation space. So they worked closely with us on that as one example. We have a couple of other activities that one should come out soon, and then another that we're working on with them as well. The regional innovation engines that were just released about a month and a half ago now, they had 10 regional innovation engines that they awarded, four of which were clearly within that climate resiliency sustainability space. So again, I think that that innovation market-driven part of, you know, use-inspired research, the climate community is really coming forward and being quite successful with TIP. So it's been for us a great partnership, but I think also for the community, it's been a really good way to explore a broader range of the sectors that are so critical to being able to find climate solutions. I don't know if that answered all of your question, but
yeah, thanks. That helps a lot. I wasn't super familiar with it, so thanks.
Yeah, again, it is a new directorate. I think they're still, they're new. They're finding their identity. They're doing some really innovative things that I think we'd like to try and adopt. Everything from how they're soliciting proposals to how they're tracking responses. So they have a good feel for the geographic range of their investments. We also have realized that they speak a little bit of a different language than we do. We're in the geosciences at NSF, we haven't really traditionally been as involved in innovation. So we have a rotator who we share her jointly with TIP, and she's been fabulous at really helping to build those spaces or find those spaces where we really intersect. So I think you'll see a lot of good things coming out of that.
Thank you. Brad.
Thanks. And thanks for being here, Alex. So I'm going to try to kind of phrase an issue and then see if I can identify a question to help you figure out how to respond. And the issue involves the recognition that environmental science, in fact, broadly science overall, is much more tied to societal needs and societal outcomes than it ever has been. And climate change, oceans themselves, there's lots of different ways in which societal need is demanded or expected of the scientists. And I think in general, scientists want to contribute in that space, but either don't have the skills or don't have the pathways to do it and aren't even certain what the kind of the expectations are. And I mean, one question would be whether in NSF, the broader impacts section of proposal writing is really being effective in ensuring that there's a pathway from science to societal outcomes, and whether NSF sees that, and if so, how, and because I'm skeptical of that, so just putting that up front. But then more broadly, whether there are things we could be looking at or thinking about or paying attention to that's already on your radar that we might be able to highlight to kind of draw attention to new approaches to ensuring a kind of a fulsome pathway from science to societal outcome.
No, that's a really good question. So two parts of the answer. The first one is just regarding the broader impacts as a criterion. The National Science Board periodically reviews the review criterion, and they're actually in the process of doing that now. So at the last meeting, they reported that they've reaffirmed that they feel that that's still an important element of the merit review. So that's sort of an aside. I think to get to your point about, you know, integrating societal need, we recognize that this is, it's absolutely critical, as you say. I think that we're seeing it less being part of or addressed in broader impacts as much as just being an absolute core part of the proposals. So if you, for example, look at the recently released CHIRP solicitation, we've learned so much with programs such as Navigating the New Arctic about the importance of incorporating community-driven research needs into a research portfolio from the start. But that, I think you're going to see that in the societal need and outcomes actually being, you know, a core part of what we're asking for in proposals, and not something that's just, you know, kind of an ancillary thing, because it is so critical, that need to tie to community. We also recognize that in formulating the calls for proposals or activities that we are thinking of, we need to have that expertise as well. So it's another place where we've done some hires, bring rotators in that kind of specialize in that climate change connection to society space as a research portfolio, and having them come and help us really build that from the start. And certainly, as far as the agency-wide theme of build a resilient planet, this the essential nature of tying in societal connections from the start is just central to all the things we've been discussing. So I see it as evolving away from just being a part of the merit review and broader impacts to really being central to how we're thinking of finding better understanding the science, better understanding community needs, and moving towards our way of any way we can contribute towards solutions.
So is part of that to think about that calls would include explicitly an expectation of a wider disciplinary participation beyond science itself, because scientists are good at science, but not necessarily good at social science or community engagement, if that's part of the expectation of the outcomes. And so it requires perhaps a shift in the way in which calls themselves are structured, or the expectation of who is eligible for calls and who should be participating in calls.
Well, so I would argue social science is a science first, but I also, yes, we are restructuring the calls, but again, we'll always be supporting that foundational research in the core programs where it's what we've always said, give us your best and brightest ideas. So there's these two things together, and they feed into each other. You know, again, a lot of the advances that have been made have come from the core programs. We can then develop specialized programs that maybe amplify elements of that. But one of those elements is really this tie to the need to be connected to community. The community needs are really going to drive some of the research we need to invest in to better understand impacts. Impacts are happening so fast. We need to understand how they're impacting people. And so we already have been putting that as a central part of many of the solicitations we've been releasing. But again, I need to emphasize that our the core research investments to really get at the physics you know, all the necessary components of a changing climate, how it's impacting ecosystems, that is all still being supported.
Cool. Yeah, thanks.
Thanks very much, Alex. It's great to hear about all these things. I have a question about your sort of infrastructure needs a little bit, but I was sort of also really curious, if you don't mind me asking, about one of the things you just said about community consultation and driven research about the new Arctic, I think you called it. And oftentimes people in the field use community as being the community of other oceanographers. Do you mean the actual people living there and using it? Just checking.
Yes, exactly. So navigating the new Arctic was one of the big ideas under the previous director, and they all had a sunset time. But we learned, obviously, there was a lot of good science supported in that program. But I think the most critical things we learned was really how to work with communities, indigenous communities, using indigenous knowledge as part of research. So, yes, I mean communities, meeting people where they are.
That's fabulous. I just wanted to check on that because that's what it was, frankly. But I was also thinking about the infrastructure and one of the sort of exciting things that goes on in conversations in sort of the biology sphere of this, particularly biological oceanography, is thinking about a shipless future for oceanographic research and, you know, using AUVs, using other ways of getting data without the billion-dollar ships or whatever they cost. And so I just wonder is there a conversation going on like that in the geosciences? I know there is in sort of the bio side.
I don't know of a full shipless feature, but certainly I think the need to have, obviously observations are one of our big challenges as far as better understanding a climate system that's changing quite a lot, probably a lot more rapidly than we ever thought it would. And so we're obviously going to always be observation poor and how we can do that more efficiently. Right. You know, as you well know, ships are expensive. And I think, you know, over the years, that's been a really important partnership we've had with ONR, where they've developed a lot of technologies that or, you know, again, synergistic developments of technologies that have really helped. So it is, I think, something that is always in the discussion. Of, you know, those are investments that are really critical. We just had a Dear Colleague letter that was released last year. I'm trying to think of when last year, but they just started getting the first round of proposals that was really tied to instrumentation for extreme environments, of which the ocean is considered one. And it was actually kind of specifically targeting in part the ocean. And better, and again, making those investments in tools. The challenge is, as you know, that it, you know, if we think of gliders and when they first started, you know, being deployed versus, you know, the amazing things that they are able to do now was a long time. And so I think that's a challenge too, is there's no easy fix. And so how can we, again, some of these partnerships with industry, if we can find those things that have resonance, and we're never going to have the market that maybe cell phones have. But, you know, again, I think as the need to better understand and collect data regionally, I think that's possibly a creative space that we could do more in. But I do think that is an important area.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. And y'all are right on time. I don't see any other hands up, but before we let you go, Alex, I just want to make sure our co-chairs don't have any other questions.
Ajit jumped in.
Oh. Sorry. I'm still struggling with something. So, Alex, I wonder if you want to say anything at all about where you see GEO and maybe OC, if you want to go there, on the whole I don't like that. So I'm going to not call it build the resilient planet. I'm going to call it the steward the resilient planet, because I don't think we're going to build it. We're going to take care of the one we have.
Wasn't my name. Wasn't my words, but I get you.
Yeah, but you get what I mean. I was wondering about your thoughts on that, because that's one of the four major themes. And I'm thinking that some decisions on resource allocation is based on how well it serves the themes. If I'm not right about that, that doesn't matter.
Right now, what we're doing with the themes is we're trying to, I think the challenge we've been facing with the themes is that we, for example, Resilient Planet, that is both the investments we make in climate as well as those made in clean energy. We haven't seen a lot of extra funding going into it. And so one thing we're working on now with the National Science Board is thinking more about kind of strategic road mapping in this space of really where do we need to go and how can we, what's the right way to put it? We're obviously making, as I said, in the core programs, we're making investments in this space all the time. I agree with you. I don't necessarily, I just prefer we call it Resilient Planet and leave it at that. But I think what we're trying to do is be a little more strategic in how we frame it. What we don't want to do, I think, is we're confusing everybody by releasing tons of solicitations. I think we're hearing that message loud and clear. So I think we're thinking of how can we do more, say, copy how Ocean Science does their, they don't have solicitations for their core programs. They have program announcements. Could for Resilient Planet, we have a broad agency-wide program announcement that would essentially point the community to priority areas within that broad theme. And for example, you know, is wildfire work is supported all through the foundation. Is there a way that if we can better point the community to those places and then extra funds that become available without releasing a solicitation? This is, I guess I'm rambling a bit here. I think in some cases our mechanisms get in the way too. And so I think we're trying to think about how to better navigate having this broad theme. We don't want to get too directed, but I think there's going to be clear priorities that are going to come from the administration. And you know, how do we organize that within the NSF construct? I'm totally didn't answer your question again. I failed you twice in one call.
These are tough questions. One more question, if you can stay on just for another minute, Alex, is that okay?
Sure. Yeah.
Mona, last question.
Thank you so much, Kelly. Alex, thanks so much for spending time with us. I learned a lot. I have a question with respect to something that you've said regarding reuse-inspired research and the value of societal applications. There are significant power imbalances when it comes to doing that kind of work between the institutions, our ones in particular, and the community partners. I know NSF has, for example, the Granted Initiative that is bringing our, you know, minority serving institutions and our two universities and colleges up to, you know, increasing their capacity. What is NSF doing with respect to dismantling that power structure between the communities that we're going to work with and the faculty at research universities?
Yeah, that's a really good question. We are very cognizant of it, and we are, so Granted, of course, is an NSF-wide initiative for those that are unaware of, really recognizing that emerging research institutions just don't have, they may have one person that can sign off proposals, and if they're on leave, that's it, everyone's done. So we're trying to help where we can in that space. I think we are trying to focus more. So I don't know if you saw, we have a solicitation that came out about 6 weeks ago called Forecast, that's really aimed at a student level. So it's got two tracks. One is supporting rising seniors at emerging research institutions and forming a national cohort and investing in them by paying, first of all, paying their salary on the GS, on the government GS scale. Because what that does is it takes into account the fact that if you have a student at an emerging research institution somewhere in LA versus a student that's in Lawrence, Kansas, they have very different expenses, and the GS scale inherently accommodates for locality pay. So it automatically will compensate for that difference, which, you know, money's a real barrier too. So, but the idea is to create these cohorts of rising seniors where they will have access to leadership training, communications training, entrepreneurship training, and again, the science training needed to work within the resiliency, sustainability, climate space. The track two, again, will follow a similar thing where they'll be compensated on the GS, at this point, a GS7 scale. These will be more institution-based cohorts, recognizing that it's focused at terminal master's level because we desperately need a workforce that can work in the climate resiliency sustainability space that has different skill sets than we maybe have been focusing on. So it's focusing more to master's level, but again, forming these cohorts that will be now in the master's level working together institutionally. And so with the idea being of building the next generation workforce that we're gonna need. And we've had someone give a talk a couple weeks ago on climate modeling. And we got talking about really the need for folks that maybe aren't writing the model code, they're not studying the physics, but they can interpret the models like a meteorologist interprets weather model output. And those are sort of things we haven't really thought about. We need to create these geoscience pathways because we're losing a lot of geoscience students. In part, the feedback we get is that they don't want to be academics and they don't want their PhD, but they do want to help their communities. So how can we develop an educated workforce that sees themselves as helping their communities? And so this is where, for example, forecasts we're targeting. But we see that the emerging research institutions are really that superhighway of finding those students that they really do. Again, they want to stay where they are and they want to help their communities. Obviously not all of them, but I think, you know, I'm really excited about that solicitation. I really recommend you have a look at it. I think it's really innovative and it's really creating a buzz through the foundation because it's not just focused on geoscience, recognizing that link between geoscientists and engineers and geoscientists and biologists, although we have a lot of biology in geo, but just again, it's really thinking across boundaries.
That's great. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Alex. Thank you for staying on. Those were some tough questions and you covered a lot of ground and gave us a lot to think about. Really appreciate you taking the time to be with us. So thank you. And thanks, committee, for all the excellent questions.
That was great talking to you. Thanks for the invite.
Absolutely. All right. So now we will transition to the next part of the agenda. This is a session on science monitoring and reliable telecommunications for smart cables. We have research professor Bruce Howell joining us from the University of Hawaii at Manila. And then he'll be followed by Zhonglin Zhen, a professor of geophysics from the California Institute of Technology. Thanks so much for being here with us. Bruce, you're first. And if you want to try sharing your screen.
You need to enable it for me.
Do I?
Okay. You should be set.
Okay, good. All right, good. Let me move things a bit here, just a second. Okay, so thanks for inviting me, and I'll be giving a status report and looking towards the future for smart cables specifically, and then also some personal views on what I call smart plus, going farther beyond that. And as was mentioned, Zhonglin Zhen will follow with a complementary new sensing technology, optical fiber sensing, and so on. So the two do go together very well. So here I show sort of a summary. The basic concept is to, for smart cables, science monitoring, and reliable telecommunications, to create a planetary sensor network, distributing power and internet on the seafloor, specifically to form a global array that can observe climate, oceans, sea level, earthquakes, and tsunamis. The fundamental assumption is it shares a submarine cable infrastructure as new cables go in, replacing existing cables as shown. We can build up a network like this. With sensors spaced every 100, 200 kilometers and so on. By knowing the environment, we can protect the network itself for the benefit of the telecom people as well. The two, I show various symbols of systems that are in play, and I'll say more about those. The main point is the two green ones are funded and will be installed in 2026. So why are we doing this? Well, climate change and disaster risk reduction. You all know the global overturning circulation conveyor belt and so on. And we would be measuring aspects directly connected to that. Ocean heat content, circulation, sea level rise, and then of course, earthquake and tsunamis on the much shorter range of disaster risk reduction. Just two slides, a little more specific. Deep ocean temperature is increasing. Ocean temperature is an essential ocean variable. We're basically looking at one part of the Earth system energy budget, and that is still a major source of error in everything related to climate. On the right side, a map of sea level, and that's always changing spatially and temporally due to thermal expansion, but then also melting ice and so on. And then more directly about ocean circulation, water flows from high pressure to low pressure, basically. And by measuring pressure gradients, for instance, across an ocean basin like the Atlantic, we can get a measure of part of the ocean circulation by just measuring pressure as part of the meridional overturning circulation. And in one sense, we're contributing also to understanding the sort of complete sea level budget. More on earthquakes and tsunamis, the red dots show earthquakes, and will vastly increase the number of sensors related to tsunami detection, directly measuring the surface. And then just basic geophysics, imaging the Earth's interior, and so on. So we will be just yet another component of the ocean observing toolbox, but importantly, we'll be measuring the bottom boundary condition, which is almost totally unobserved at the moment, with two essential ocean variables, temperature and pressure. We succeeded in making pressure an essential ocean variable. So how are we going to do this? Every 70-100 kilometers is what's called an optical amplifier repeater, where the telecom signals in the optical fibers are amplified and passed on, and there's electric power available as well. So the basic idea is piggyback on this and add temperature, pressure, and seismic sensors. I note that there are several companies involved in this. Alcatel Submarine Networks is the largest supplier of such systems, and they're totally on board and are signed up for the contracts with the two systems I mentioned. And they will have broadband seismometers up to 100 hertz. They'll have what's called A0A, low drift pressure sensors, and also temperature. So here are the two systems that are funded. And this is basically bringing in outside money. It's a line item in the full Portuguese government budget. Furthermore, the European Union has stood up, and the connectivity part of the European Union is supplying money, including for environmental sensing, for cables to outlying territories. Azores and Madeira are outlying, and they're getting 40 million euros from that source. And for New Caledonia, Vanuatu, France is funding a large part of it. Main thing to keep in mind is these systems last more than 25 years. Engineering life is 25 years. With my Aloha Cable Observatory, it's running at 36 years now. So these are long lasting, and it's reliable, and low lifetime cost is an important thing to keep in mind. The Portuguese system is equivalent to one or two DART tsunami warning buoys over the lifetime. As I said, Xiang Wen will talk about optical fiber sensing, which will be included in both of these. So here are some systems where we're in the talking stage still. Medusa through the Mediterranean, off New Zealand, Chatham Islands, in the Arctic region, several systems, Polar Connect, connecting Europe to Japan and Far North Fiber. And there's another that just came out, TUSAS, connecting Greenland to Denmark, which would be fantastic for AMOC studies and complementing OSNAP, for instance. And lower right, to this NSF audience, NSF has proposed a smart cable from New Zealand to Antarctica, 5,000 kilometers, and have already invested $4 million in the planning and technical studies. And there'll be yet another science workshop. I might say that in all of these, there have been science workshops that call not just for smart cable capability, but more, which I'll talk about. So there's always a tension between keeping it simple and getting broad distribution and asking for more. So let me just conclude this portion of my talk on the smart cable part explicitly, that it's a marriage with telecom. It's really the only way we can get such global coverage by sharing the cost burden, basically 10 or 15% additional cost for the sensing. So three for the price of one, and recognizing that these cables are always being replaced over time slowly, new routes and so on. So in the next 15 years, the number of kilometers will double. And it's a $5 billion a year industry that we should take advantage of with 180 years of experience. Long life, highly reliable, again, unusual funding sources from our perspective. And we have these recent successes that will set valuable precedents for future systems. We are deeply ingrained in the Goose system. We will be classified as an emerging Goose network this May, and involved in the Tsunami Program, Ocean Decade, and Deep Ocean Observing Strategy, NSF funded project. And in the future, one can look to the fundamental fact that we're making power and communication available on the seafloor. And we have to take it slowly. We don't want to overwhelm the industry, but you can imagine other sensors being slowly incorporated into future systems as they become qualified for such long life and low drift. There are challenges. We're addressing all these with these first systems. So we encourage everyone to think globally. As a global part of the global ocean observing system, but then obviously act locally and regionally, all for research, operations, and saving lives. Okay, so the next part is absolutely my personal opinion, and what I'll introduce what I'm calling Smart Plus, and it's my comments are influenced by my background in ocean acoustic tomography, mobile systems and cable systems, Neptune and OI and the ACO. So part of this talk, the topic for today is ocean infrastructure. And so I'm making these statements that, you know, they're infrastructure services that are essential to conducting any activity in our civilization. And the fundamental one is power. And everything depends on power, communications, position, navigation, timing, and sensing. And then how do you implement that with elements, cables, fixed platforms, mobile platforms, and so on. So as I see it, cables are a sine qua non for everything else. And to make it affordable, one has to share it with telecom. On the right side is a figure I drew 24 years ago. For the Neptune effort, and you know, we've succeeded in part. The green check marks, power, high power, and high bandwidth, and science nodes, and using ROVs and intense sampling areas. Sort of, you know, we've connected to a few boreholes, a couple of moorings are cable connected. Wally the rover has been connected since 2009, but with absolutely failed in three other areas, One is meshing the network, which is much more technical, and provision of navigation for autonomous vehicles or even maintenance purposes. And down on the lower right is a glaring omission that NSF and ONR should be really chastised for not doing, which is AUV docking and all the capability that AUVs could bring to the table. They're so underutilized, and it's just like electric vehicles. We need those charging stations out there, and to support those, the cables. So let me just show a little evolution here. We're talking KISS, smart cables being KISS, keep it simple, stupid. A few sensors at each unit, but global coverage, and now with optical fiber sensing. So the next step is to add a little more capability, and one is demonstrated in a test system off Japan, where there's a single underwater mateable connector installed in a repeater, and so that opens up new possibilities at an in-between cost to ultimately a node just like OOI or Neptune and so on, which are absolutely, you know, quite very expensive and could only be in a few locations. But nonetheless, coupling all this with telecom systems is advantageous because the overall cost would be reduced. So I have this little cartoon, forgive me, it's pretty simple, but showing this progression. So we have telecom cables with those repeaters every 100 kilometers. And the next step is to add optical fiber sensing from shore capability. Basically just from shore side, you can learn a lot by using the fiber as mainly a strain sensor at the picometer level at various resolutions. So the next step is add smart repeaters with temperature, pressure, and seismics, and then hydrophones, because there's in all the science workshops, they want hydrophones. And then ONG select repeaters or nodes add more capability with single ports, for instance, with acoustic modems that would enable local networks of battery operated sensors and so on, and more flexibility. Adding these more complicated branch nodes. I mean, they're very specialized and expensive, and you'd have to really pick and choose where they go and so on, but they would enable and meshing. They would, with mobile platforms, enable acoustic tomography to measure speed of sound and thus temperature and heat con over ocean basin, and then the long range navigation and communication for the autonomous platforms that are in there. And measuring, for instance, velocity at high resolution, measuring Doppler, you know, to within a millimeter per second, for instance. So one example, again, biased by my background, is showing existing acoustic tomography and navigation underway now. In the Arctic, people at Scripps and in Norway are installing arrays that measure the Atlantic layer of the central Arctic Ocean. And simultaneously providing navigation for gliders and floats. So that's one example underway, and could be replicated in the other ocean basins. On the right side, the Kauai Beacon acoustic source funded by ONR is transmitting off Kauai to the West Coast and to Wake Island CTBT hydrophones. With stable arrivals and so on. And so basically building on the legacy of ATOC, we want to use OOI resources and other hydrophones that are now in place to receive these signals and perform acoustic thermometry, as well as providing the long range navigation. So concluding here, I feel that these two Smart and Smart Plus are within reach in the coming decade, but it will require investment. This recognizes the deep ocean is still largely unknown. There are just a handful of real-time temperature measurements even in the deep ocean, let alone more complex ones in real time and so on. So I hope I don't have to persuade all of you that the deep ocean is essential understanding for science. So from a technical point of view, we need these particular elements to be developed further. AUVs, we've got to make use of those capabilities with docking stations so they can leapfrog from one to the next, be out there for a long duration, carry calibrations around to sensors or have more complex sensors, eDNA, mass specs, you know, all those kind of things could be on AUVs so they can be serviced more often and yet sample the ocean in a controlled way. Part of this also requires better modeling. So much of data is the quality of data is lost in representation error. We need better sensors that last a long time. We need to incentivize the US industry in this situation and engage other agencies. And this would appear to me a perfect one for the tip part of NSF. And lastly, this has to be an international collaboration. Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much, Bruce. Let's go on, it's at the top of the hour. Let's go on and move to Jean Wen, and then we'll save the questions for the audience, right?
Okay, sounds good. I look at the agenda, I realize you all have been sitting here for quite a while. So I'm Jean Wen, I'm a professor in seismology, so I'm pretty new to this community here. I mostly study earthquakes, but recently also getting more excited about applications of seismic tools in geography. So today I'm going to talk about the fiber sensing aspects of this topic. I hope like Bruce has did a great job convincing you we should take advantage of this submarine infrastructure for sensing purpose. So I'm just going to focus on what's different, what I'm going to talk about here. I would summarize that what Bruce was talking about was using the submarine fiber infrastructure as a platform. You add things on top of it, like add a sensor to the repeater or use the power cable to power things nearby. What I'm going to focus on is what I call fiber infrastructure as sensors. So using the fiber itself that's already in place without asking them to change anything in the wet plant to sense what's going on around the cable and the deep ocean. There were a few different technologies. I will go through each one of them. The most widely used one at the moment is called DAS, distributed acoustic sensing. This method works by connecting a DAS interrogation unit to a cable that's already in place and send a laser pulse through it and listen to the echoes coming from tiny defects. Those are manufactured defects of glass that you listen to the echoes. And if the environment around the cable is changing due to shaking, due to temperature, pressure, the echo will be slightly different. And because the defect is everywhere, you turn every few meters of the cable into a sensor. Just imagine like if you have a 100-kilometer cable, you turn that into 10,000 sensors. And also the wonderful thing is this interrogation unit is on one end of the cable. So in this case, it can be on the coast at the landing station of the cable. You don't have to put it on the seafloor. There's a lot of paper in it. This is the most popular method at the moment. I'm just going to put this general public review paper from my student, Ethan Williams on Physics Today, I believe. It shows that like DAS by turning this cable, black cable, putting a box on land, going offshore, you can detect all kinds of things, earthquakes, seismic noise, surface gravity wave, internal wave, human noise, marine animals. It does this by detecting mostly by vibration, but I want to bring a special case to your mind here is our recent paper detecting ocean internal waves on cable near the Canary Island. In this case, when we see the internal wave, as you can see in the figure to the right, this is a couple of days record over 50 kilometers. The color here is showing you the strain, but the strain is because the internal waves bring a temperature perturbation to the cable. And the cable is sensing like the shorting of the internal tides on the slope of the island, causing contraction or extension of the fiber. So you can detect both acoustic, seismic, and pressure and temperature variations along the cable. So this is really the most popular one. I don't want to dive too much in detail. There are too many papers in this domain. But I want to focus a little bit on this challenge. This method can use about 100 kilometer cable. Beyond that, the signal that's echo coming back is getting pretty weak. Okay, and also we want to use those long cables, as Bruce showed, the transatlantic, transpacific, but those are very expensive cables and they do not have a lot of fibers in them. It turns out DAS usually requires a so-called dark fiber, meaning that it's a strand of fiber that's not being used. And for submarine cable, that's very hard to come by. Okay, so there are some challenges that we have to think about. So if we kind of summarize this technology, you have the two end of the cable on land in the yellow box, you have a bunch of fibers in between, and you have these repeaters that Bruce hoped to put more sensors in. And with the DAS unit can use the first span of the cable on both ends of the cable near the landing station. And a very high resolution, very sensitive. But you cannot necessarily use all the long cables in between yet. So if I kind of compare, think about the DAS sensitivity, coverage, scalability, and the resolution, I would say it has great sensitivity and the resolution. You can detect very small signals every few meters, but its coverage is not so good for the size of the ocean. And also the scalability, if it requires dark fiber, is harder, right, for the ocean case. Another technology that come by in the last few years is called ultra-stable laser interferometry. It's basically, we sometimes call it the phase approach. What it does is put a laser, it's extremely stable laser. It's the kind of laser used in metrology to synchronize atomic clocks around the globe. And this clock will send, they will send this laser to the fiber, let it come back all the way from the far end so it can travel 10,000 kilometers and come back to this sensor. And I measure very precisely use the ultra-stable cavity, how much time it has taken for it to travel that 1,000 kilometers. And they can measure nanosecond kind of change over such a long distance, essentially measuring very small perturbation that as long as you can change the total length of the cable. Again, that can be seismic, it can be pressure, it can be temperature. This method, it can use the entire fiber all at once. It doesn't care about the repeaters, but you do need an ultra-stable laser. This laser unit, as far as I understand, is a million-dollar device. It's not like you can buy off a shelf for telecom purpose. It turns out the telecom laser line width, like the, how sharp that frequency peak is 5,000 to 10,000 hertz, while this laser used in metrology is like 1 hertz laser. So it's extremely good. So it's very sensitive, but very expensive at the same time. And also it's taking the entire cable as one sensor. You do not have a good idea where this thing change is happening. So if I compare phase approach with the DAS approach, I would say it has excellent coverage. It can cover the entire ocean all at once. It has great sensitivity. Actually, the way it measures things is very sensitive, similar to the DAS approach. But it, because of the long integration, you have more noise. Resolution, not so good. You are using the 1,000 kilometer as one sensor. Scalability, well, this metrology laser is just very expensive and actually also very big. It's not easy to just plug it in and play. A few years ago, we looked into this problem. We said, is there another cheaper way of doing this? And then we come up with the idea of a state of polarization. So the idea is that when telecom people try to use this, a few strands of fiber they have, they try to maximize their capacity as much as they can. And one of the approaches is called polarity multiplexing, right? So basically you try to send two signals orthogonal to each other so that you double the capacity. But then on the other end, you need to restore it, right? You need to separate the two. So the way you do it, you keep track of the polarization of light. It turns out if somewhere along the entire cable, the cable is being perturbed by whatever reason, then the polarization would change. We actually show that you can change, monitor this polarization and sense earthquakes and waves along the way. We did a one try using a 10,000 kilometer cable from Los Angeles to Chile, showing the red line here. We were able to actually detect dozens of earthquakes all along the cable, showing as the yellow stars here, right? And the most amazing thing in this case, we actually didn't even go to the plant to add our instrument because the telecom people need to measure polarization anyway. So they just send us the data file and we were able to detect earthquakes. Not only we detect earthquake, this is actually showing you the spectrogram of those data. And you can see on the top figure, all these tiered lines, those are actually ocean swell event. On the bottom, I just showing other data for the reference. You can see we see beautiful ocean swells. So we can also detect pressure waves. So again, like anything that is perturbing it, you can detect. If I compare this with the other two approach, the most amazing thing is it has long range, cover entire cable. It also doesn't need any new instrument, just getting the readings would be enough. But it also has a disadvantage that it's the entire 10,000 kilometer is one sensor. So if I again compare on this four different quantities, I would say the polarization approach has a great coverage and is extremely scalable. As long as they are doing polarization multiplexing, we already have the sensors. But the resolution is pretty bad. Okay, we don't know where it's happening. And the sensitivity is also lower because polarization can be affected, more sensitive is affected by all kinds of other things that we may not care about. So this was the state of art 2 years ago. The amazing thing is fiber sensing is just such a young field. Like everything is progressing really quickly. DAS only emerged about 10 years ago to become sensitive enough for scientific research purpose. The phase approach and the polarization approach all happened in the last 5 years, 7 years, right? So for example, I'll tell you a few major progresses recently. This is another method of DAS, very similar, just using slightly different frequencies. So this figure here shows actually the attenuation you get from propagating light in a fiber. And you want it to be attenuation to be as low as possible. So you want to be in this 1550 nanometer wavelength. That's called the C band. So that's where the telecom people are going. And that's why we, when we do DAS, we want to avoid that. In the past, we have to use dark fiber. But right now there is an airband DAS, basically goes to 1600, a little bit longer wavelength. Now you can do DAS on the same cable that's already used for telecom without wiring interference. So suddenly we don't need a dark fiber anymore. And we can coexist with the telecom. Suddenly the scalability become a lot better. So I would say it's becoming very fairly easy to do, even though the technology is pretty new. And the phase approach used to be using the entire cable as one sensor. But in 2022, Mara's team showed that actually within the repeaters, the telecom people already have something called high loop, high loss loop DAC. Essentially those dashed lines showing on the top figure. Some of the energy can go to the repeater and come back. So now he can measure the phase change, not go through the entire cable and come back, but go to each one of the repeater and come back. And then if you subtract the difference between two neighboring repeaters, you can measure the phase change caused by the sectional fiber between that two repeater. Suddenly the resolution goes from 10,000 kilometers to 100 kilometer. And this method, I think, suddenly improved the resolution of the method substantially. And we saw that method and say, oh, if you can do it with phase, I could do it with polarization. Well, we said we found a cable with this loop back, we borrow the same idea, except that he's subtracting phase information. We are trying to rotate the polarization. Skipping the details, now we can also do every 100 kilometer resolution using polarization method. So suddenly the coverage of this diagram here become a lot broader. You might still argue that there is no single method on this diagram that covers all four corners. You can see that some of them are covering different edges of this diagram. So there's no perfect, like one solution for all of them. But if you combine them, they kind of cover a pretty large range here. And the most amazing thing is you don't have to change how telecom industry do things. You need to add these things on their own land to turn them into sensors. So here by summary, multiple emerging summary sensing technologies are coming up. I talked about dust, phase, and polarization. I would not be surprised if the industry were come up with something new. It turns out in the last few years, as they see what we can do, they are also investing more to developing this kind of sensing technologies. And they are progressing really quickly. You know, most of this technology are becoming useful for research in the last decade. And some of them only appeared in the last 5 years. And we are the potential, I think they're still huge that we don't know yet. It benefits both submarine geophysics and oceanography because it does not only detect seismic waves, it detects whatever perturbs the cable. That can be temperature, that can be pressure, that can be acoustic signals. And I think a cocktail solution is necessary for the best outcome. There is no one that can fit all of them. And finally, I think I want to emphasize that almost all these fiber sensing technology are developed jointly by academia and the telecom industry. Okay. They are interested in this for some of the cable protection and adding value to their cables. And we are interested in for the research purpose. I think there could be a very nice synergy here, you know, to develop better, more robust, more sensitive method. I think that's maybe where you know, NSF or other agencies can help us facilitate this kind of collaborations that'll be better. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Wow, you guys covered quite a bit. I see some applause in the chat there. Please go ahead and if anybody has questions for Bruce or for Zhang Wen, please raise your virtual hand.
I see Maya has hands up.
Maya. Hi, apologies, I'm in a car. Thanks so much, it was really interesting. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about the science applications, particularly around the temperature sensing from the cables. And are you getting individual temperature measurements every meter, or are you getting an average temperature across the ocean basin?
Right.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So the different technology has different sensitivity. The DAS approach would be measuring temperature every 10 meters along the cable. And they have a really high sampling rate in time. So it's basically something like for seismic purpose, we're sampling about 500 hertz, right? But DAS approach has a little bit less stability over very long time scales because of the laser. It's not particularly stable over very long time scales. Their other approach, the phase and the polarization approach, would be measuring temperature average over about 100 kilometers. So that's the length between the repeaters. Maybe this is too small for some problems, but this could be very useful for certain type of problems. If you're looking at some larger scale processes, you know, we're talking a lot with oceanographers here, like the mesoscale problems or bigger scale problems could be very useful. We do have to do a lot more work in calibrating the temperature side because that depends a lot on the fiber design side aspects.
Maybe I could just add something to that, that at least my understanding is the fiber is measuring strain basically. I mean, there's some index of refraction change, but basically you're getting one number out and there's a convolution of all the different physical processes and you're getting one number out. And so part of the challenge, I think, in the research going on now is to separate those different processes from one another. So, you know, solid earth processes, you know, short-term, long-term, and then the ocean processes. And then also it's to convert whatever result is to a form that could be ultimately assimilated into an ocean model. So there's a long, long chain of research that needs to go on to make these measurements useful all the way into the operational sense. But they absolutely do show great potential.
Jim?
Yeah, that was a great presentation, really exciting possibilities. I had one question. I think I understood you to say right at the end of your talk, Dr. Zahn, is that some of the research that's going on in the academic community is may benefit the telecommunications community in terms of how to get better access or better performance out of their cables. Did I understand that right? And if so, it sounds like a good potential for maybe a combined research program funded by TIPS.
Right. There's a few reasons for that, why they care about sensing as well. First of all, generally, they don't care, but they care for certain reasons. One is they want to protect their cable. And fixing a cable is a very expensive thing. Yeah. If they have any way to monitor the cable so that they can be prepared or reduce the problem, that's a big, big benefit for them. So the DAS approach right now is high resolution enough for them to even take action in some case. Like if a fishing boat is trawling near the cable, they might be able to warn them, so don't go across my cable, right? So that's one extreme example. It's a good example of that, right? Longer sensing technologies that only have tens of kilometer resolution may be harder, but maybe there are ways we can use those information, like submarine landslide could be another example that we can know better about. On the other hand, the submarine cable industry is an extremely competitive industry. And anything that gives them an edge over their competitors, meaning they add a component that provides additional value, is a plus, and that could change the game. So some of the companies might be interested to say, you know, this doesn't add much price, but give you this new information you can have. And that could change, you know, that could be enough of motivation for some of these telecom equipment providers.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks very much for that presentation. I was wondering if you can tell us, I'm following up on Marsha's question in the chat, about how what kind of acoustic information can be obtained. Can either of you talk anything about the current state of art or science in terms of soundscape in the deep ocean from these cables?
Yeah, as Zhang Wen said, the DAS can go up, I've seen 1,000 hertz and so on, and that would be near shore typically. And the sensors on these, the smart modules, at least one provider is saying up to 100 hertz. It's in the form of a broadband seismometer, and many people in the seismic community have already shown that seismometers can basically pick up low frequency acoustics. So I don't know the numbers on sensitivity there, but definitely, you know, marine mammals and ships show up on broadband seismic sensors. So that will be available at the low frequency and so on. I guess, you know, 80, 90 hertz, something like that.
Right. So I'm
sorry. Can I just jump in on that? So, sure. So Bruce, can you also like detect calving events and ice cracking and things like that?
Well, again, it all depends on, you know, source level and distance and the frequency. So presumably, yes. I mean, yeah.
So maybe I can answer Marsha's question more specifically. For the kind of processes you are talking about, because not only we need to detect them, we need to be able to say something about them, right? So that doesn't mean higher resolution is required. So I think that would be the best case for the kind of DAS scenario. It would be wonderful if at some point we could have a portable, you know, kind of instrument for that purpose, like getting cables very close to a research target. We do that all the time on land. Like last year, we take a cable, you know, to Antarctica and we do some research there. And there are other people go to other glaciers, look at icequakes, right? We respond to a big earthquake to catch aftershocks. We do that all the time. But ocean is a lot harder. So that would be the right technology, but there need to be development about how to make it portable, deployable quickly in the ocean scenarios.
Steve?
Yeah, thank you very much for all that. I'm curious about the other uses of this cable array. It looks like there's only going to be, you know, it's an amazing thing. There's not going to be 12 of them in the world to be, you know, this huge array does all these things. And that's really cool. Both of you have talked about the physical sensing capability of these arrays. I'm just a biologist, but I'm just like curious, what kinds of developments are there going on to actually sense the biological community that's out there, just as important, just as amazing, just as critical? Bruce mentioned AUVs and environmental DNA, which is really cool. You've been talking about sensors that convert, you know, can listen for sound that's biologically based. What else is going on in the community around these sensor arrays that is moving in that direction, do you think?
Well, I would say I don't detect anything special going on just for the cable application. It's just sensing in general for biology. And I mean, ever since I've been involved in cables with Neptune back in 1997, you know, it's what sensors will live long enough to make useful measurements and over a long time period without drift. And, you know, this came up, you know, 2 weeks ago. I was in Barcelona at the UN Decade Conference, and, you know, a biologist from Azores came up and said, well, when are you going to get biological sensors on the Portuguese system? Well, give me one that will last. And, you know, there's no answer. So, you know, it's a sensor community in general that needs to work on this. I mean, if there's a sensor that'll last the reasonable length of time, you know, from a calibration point of view, then it could be incorporated in new packages.
Right.
So on the fiber sensing side, because we are generally using existing telecom cables, we cannot control the property of that. So if whatever process that is not perturbing the cable, then it's not going to be detected. So that's just the baseline there. But on the other hand, there are specialty sensing fibers you can engineer and you can deploy them. Okay, in that case, you might put a special surface or jacketing of the fiber so that it responds to a particular kind of chemical, for example, a particular biological signature that you want to have, and then it will cause the fiber to respond to that, and then we will be able to detect that. So I know that people do distributed chemical sensing over fibers. So that's kind of in the direction, but it doesn't mean you cannot then take advantage of the existing telecom cables anymore, which I think is one of the major points. Like, we don't need to wait for the new cables to go in or ask them to put special cables.
Yeah, so in a smart module, if such a fiber existed, you could attach that to the smart module and string it out, you know, some short distance, presumably along the outside of the cable and so on. But again, you need that power and communication interface for those local measurements.
So in general, what I'm getting is that the development of biological sensors is a huge future area of development that isn't there yet. If it were there, then it could take advantage of these broad sort of cable arrays.
Right. Yes.
Thank you. Marcia.
So on the AUV issue, what existing AUVs had the robustness for long-term residents on the ocean that you could utilize?
I don't know specifics, but I know they're reasonable size ones that can last for 5 or 10 days. And so presumably if there was a docking station to go with them, you know, they could be out indefinitely. To my knowledge, they're only two commercial docking stations, and the one I know is it's geared towards oil field, sort of local 10 kilometer kind of scale. And yes, other docking stations have been developed, you know, one off and so on. But to my knowledge, there are none really operational, and especially for the medium size that are within the reach of academics to afford.
Thank you. Rick?
Yeah, just because one of our members is in the car, she typed something in, so I'm going to read it just to make sure it gets noticed. So Maya Tolstoy typed in the chat, other than the portable system that Zongwen mentioned, what's the biggest challenge or gap, or on the flip side, the opportunity to scale this work up?
I love that question. Bruce, do you want to take it first?
Well, I think it's maybe it's directed to you, but for us, I mean, we are at the global scale, or can be. There's no additional challenge. The technical work being done by the companies is absolutely geared towards, you know, providing the capability across any ocean basin. So that's the scaling is not an issue. It's a cost associated with scaling. You know, that's the issue as always. But technically, it's the solution is going to be demonstrated in 2026.
Right. So on the fiber sensing side, I think it's there. We need a faster iterations on this. So as I said, fiber sensing end of the spectrum is a very young, very new, and it's progressing very fast. If you have a new idea of fiber sensing and you want to test on a transoceanic cable, that's not easy to do. Okay, these cables are very hard to access. And the telecom companies, this is not their highest priority, right? So it turns out usually if you want to improve the technology, I believe there is a huge potential, but it's not as fast as I hoped to make mm-hmm. this technology even better. And this is really coming down to, you know, most of these companies are doing this as, you know, some of their best scientists, engineers and scientists, the personal interest in some of this process. So if there is a mechanism, right, to have a more structured collaboration between industry and the academia, and so that the test can be done much more quickly, right, in lab and in real environment, and they communicate their different knowledge. Like the biggest challenge I have been having is to understand what they're talking about, right? All these devices, you know, and they need to understand what I need, like what kind of measurement do I need? What kind of noise level do I need? So if there is a mechanism to have a more structured interaction between this community and do very fast iterations, I think the progress is gonna be a lot faster.
Thank you very much. Interesting answers.
Thanks, Rick, for asking Maya's question as well. Bruce, are your hands up? Is that in response to this one or a different question?
I was going to respond to Pat Smith's comment in the chat.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So Pat is asking, let's see, where is it? Okay. What would the role of NSF be to stimulate development of needed technology? So for smart cables, I think it's really, a wonderful thing would be to actually get a U.S. manufacturer involved, Subcom, and then perhaps in the form of a shore end off Antarctica that would be a prelude to the longer cable that's been proposed. So that could fit within perhaps a, what's it called, mid-size infrastructure, you know, framework and so on. And that would hopefully stimulate more U.S. Supplier activity. Presently, you know, the single largest supplier is in France. I mean, they are the largest supplier. The U.S. one is number two in the world, but they have not stepped up to do it, and they need some extra motivation. So, you know, to promote this more, especially from the U.S. funding context, is to get the U.S. government more involved and making positive statements about implementing smart cables.
Thank you, Bruce. Mark, and then Jim, and then we'll probably need to wrap this up.
So I was wondering if you could just talk a little bit more about the portable systems. I guess what I'm curious about is, is it feasible to think of NSF or some entity being able to have like a facility for portable cable systems that could be deployed in different areas on a proposal by proposal basis? Or is that still too expensive or too difficult at this point in time?
Right.
Anyway, just a little bit about the kind of scalability of that.
Yeah. This is something I'm actively thinking about, and I admit that there's no such solution yet, but I really want such a solution, because we see when we happen to have cables near some particular event, how amazing it is. Like if we catch an earthquake or catch an ice event, it's just so much you're learning from it. I was hoping in the future we can do this when we need to, where we want it to be, right? So that's kind of the wish in some sense. If we think like, how can we do this? I think our big challenge is the ship time. Like whenever ship time is involved, it's very expensive. And if you want to use smaller ships and still you have cables and the dust machines, I think we have to do a little bit of like, research or engineering of the system. For example, the dust machines probably need to be smaller, lower power, right? And you need to have a cable system that you can handle in different sea environment and be able to reel them out, reel them in, right? So there are engineering challenges. I think there, again, is in some sense, like the scientists need to talk to the engineer who knows how to do that. We know, for example, at Hui and other Institute of Oceanography, there are people with such expertise, right? And if we connect the dots, I think it's possible to do some initial testings on that end. Yeah. So the short answer is no such even prototype exists. And I think it's high on my wish list.
Thanks. That's great.
If I could just add one comment. In the late 90s, I think it was, a Canadian AUV actually laid 200 kilometers of fiber under the ice in the Arctic. I have no idea whether that's been reproduced. I assume so. The Navy presumably does things like that. So, AUV deployment. Now, that means the cable is likely quite small diameter and may not last long. And, how it lies on the bottom exactly, might complicate the issue. So, anyway, AUVs might be one way to get something out there temporarily. But otherwise, it comes back down to the cost of deploying a robust cable, and from shore, if it's a kilometer or two, you can do that in a small boat. But, if it gets any longer or bigger, costs escalate. So my two bits.
Thank you, Bruce. Jim, you have the last question.
Yeah, just a real quick comment. I mean, to the extent that we understand tips, it would seem that would be the place where this sort of structured approach that Dr. Zahn mentioned between academic researchers and industry engineers that might be interested in the scientific applications, but have to mainly focus on a telecommunication application. Seems to me that would be the place for a proposal to try to get that structure.
Thank you. I'm going to write one then.
Don't blame me if it's not fun.
Yeah, I totally agree, actually. We were indeed actively thinking about this. We need to learn a little bit more about the program. Yeah, sometimes their commitment from the industry side is not easy to come by, right? So even if, funding is a big part of this, at the same time, it also depends on their cycles. If the company is doing really, really well, they often have resource or people they can invest in this. But if it's getting tight, sometimes they have to shrink. We have experienced these cycles already.
All right, thank you. Thanks so much for the wonderful presentations. We have copies on our website. Actually, Zhengwen, I'm not sure if we have yours or not, but if we don't, Zoe will reach out.
Okay.
And we've recorded the session, and it'll be up in a few days. So just thanks so much. Smart cables keep coming up in our conversations, and we thought, you know what, we better learn a little more about this. So really appreciate you guys joining us. And committee members, I emailed you the link to our closed session. If you want to log into that, we can have a quick debrief. And just thanks again. We really appreciate you taking the time out to be with us this afternoon.
Thanks a lot for the opportunity.
Okay. Likewise. See you. Good to see some of you for a long time now.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Have a good day, Bruce. Yeah.